Hello.
Radio.
Talking. Hello, this is Lori Michelle. Welcome to this broadcast of Running on Love with God on Blog Talk Radio and live on Facebook, on Running on Love on Facebook. Welcome to tonight's broadcast. As I said, this is Lori Michelle, and 7 years ago, 7.5 years ago, I was awakened to the voice of our Creator, God Himself, and He said, go get pen and paper and start writing this down. And I started writing, and 7.5 years later, I am now on Blog Talk Radio, on Facebook Live, on YouTube, and I'm sharing my messages and wisdom that I've learned over these years. And this broadcast tonight is called Food Stamps to Freedom. And the reason I'm calling it that is because I literally wound up losing everything that I ever had, all my material wealth. I wound up destitute and on food stamps and almost homeless. And the reason I want to share this very personal story is because it's very important that we learn to let go of material wealth and things. There is many lessons in what I went through. You see, about 7-8 years ago, I realized and recognized that I was going clinically deaf. I was losing my hearing, and I was a working mom. I have 3 children, and they were coming of age and getting ready to go to college, and I lived a prosperous life. We had a beautiful home. I was married. I had a beautiful home. Millionaire, a person of means, an accomplished business person with a business, and a working mother. And my expertise was marketing and sales, so obviously my ears were very important to me. They're very important to everyone, but they were my whole career. My ability to listen and connect to people was part of what I did. So I panicked. I thought, oh no, I'm going deaf. And I started praying. I'm praying very, very hard to God. I always believed in God, but I wasn't religious. I still am very observant of God's laws, but I don't consider myself religious, believe it or not. I follow His laws and I believe in God. But going back now, 7.5 years, I was praying very hard to God, and I literally woke up one morning to a male voice talking to me, and I started writing and listening to him, and I started writing journals and books, and it progressed, and I don't want to go into the gory details. It became very bad, because in this world, especially in America, when you are an average mom and you wake up to the voice of God and you run around and start telling everybody that you hear Him, they think you're nuts. And admittedly, I was very exuberant and I couldn't contain myself, and everything that came in came out of my mouth. And my family thought I was nuts, my husband thought I was nuts, and the story that I have revealed is he had me committed. They drugged me. It happened 4 times over 3 years. But I knew all along that I wasn't nuts, that it was really him, and that I was hearing spirit. I was hearing a lot of things, but I couldn't figure it all out. And over the years, I did. And 3 years into this, I realized I needed to leave my marriage and my home to save my children and my family from a train wreck. My life was spiraling out of control. Nobody was listening to me. And I left all my material wealth, and I even had to do the unthinkable and leave my children, because my marriage was unraveling. Everything was unraveling around me. I would not let go to Hashem, God. I knew it was Him. I never lost faith, and I held on strong, and I reached for Him, not less, but more. And after I left my marital home and all my belongings, I set up an apartment, I got divorced, and I invested what little I got out of the divorce. The divorce was not kind to me at all. Divorce is not kind to anyone. But what little I had left after the divorce, I invested in my charity called Running on Love, because I was guided that Running on Love was not an everyday charity, that it was really God's charity that came through me. And that's how he operates. He is concealed to us. And we sometimes stumble upon our life's purpose without realizing that he's communicating to us, and we are his instruments of bringing godliness into this world. And I thought I was just working on a beautiful charity that was all about love and giving and connecting to people that have passed away by honoring them with an act of charity. And I was hosting these 5K events and paying for them myself, just to share the joy of giving in the name of love. But what I awakened to was that it wasn't an ordinary charity, it was God's charity, and he told me and showed me visions of the future, that this charity was supposed to be something very special that was going to bring all the people of the world together under the umbrella of love and heal the world, literally bring peace. So I couldn't stop. I really didn't know if it was true, but I met other people. After I left my marriage, I met other very prophetic, clairvoyant people who saw the visions that I was being shown, that it was not an ordinary charity. It was God's charity, and it was destined to be global and beautiful and big and heal the world. That's what I was being told by many people. So I kept investing and I kept going, and I still didn't realize that I was going broke until one day I woke up and said, oh my God, I think I've gone too far. And I realized I ran through all my savings because I was so on fire for this, and I even went into debt. And by that point, I had gone deaf, I had major surgery, I had a cochlear implant, and I found myself literally on food stamps. That's how far I took my work. I couldn't let go, because the idea that I would be letting go of a charity that could possibly heal people and heal the world was too much for me to let go of. So I found myself on food stamps. I found all of a sudden that I couldn't even make my rent. And I was teetering on losing everything again. My apartment, my furniture. I was even selling my last bit of jewelry to pay my rent. And then one day it was a Saturday afternoon, which is the Sabbath, which I observe. I don't work. And I do something where I take a nap every Saturday afternoon, and I was sleeping on the sofa, and I was scared. I was looking around, and I said, oh my God, I'm going to lose everything again. I'm going to wind up homeless. What's going to happen to me? And I took my nap, and I'm laying on the sofa, and I opened my eyes and woke up. And as usual, I always wake up to the voice of Hashem, God. And I opened my eyes and he said, this is the conversation verbatim. He said, Lori. I said, hello. He said, Lori, where are you? And I said, on my sofa in my apartment. He said, Lori, where are you? And I said, I knew it was a lesson. This is how he teaches. And he said, Lori, where are you? And I said, Morristown, New Jersey. He said, Lori, where are you? I said, New Jersey. And he said, Lori, where are you? I said, somewhere in America. He said, Lori, where are you? I said, somewhere in the world. He said, that's right. He said, look around this room. And I looked around my living room and he said, it's a nice room, right? I said, yeah. He said, if this was as big as a space as you had, one room, and you had this soft sofa to lie down and sleep on, would you be okay? I said, yeah. He said, if you were somewhere in the world and all you had was a soft place to fall, but you woke up to the sound of my voice, would you be okay? And I said, yes. He has a way. You can think the world, I'm sorry for getting emotional, but the world could be unraveling. You could be literally in a foxhole in the middle of a war zone. And as long as we have him, as long as you have your connection to him, you have everything. And when I recognized that, I started to move into a place of acceptance. And the next day, I went for my morning run on Sunday morning, and I ran through the streets of Morristown. And I looked around at the old houses in Morristown, New Jersey, and I said, you know, I might wind up homeless, and maybe I would have to wind up in a homeless shelter because I couldn't pay my rent anymore. And I looked at some of these old homes and I said, wow, well, if that's a homeless shelter, making it up, and I'm looking at an old home, if I just had a room, like Hashem, God said, and a bed and a folding table and a tablecloth for Friday night for my Shabbat meal and flowers and wine, I'm okay. I really don't need things. And once I realized that, the pressure was alleviated. And suddenly, things started to unfold for me in a magical way. I moved into the acceptance of all I really needed was him, God. And one thing after the other, the next thing I knew, I was moving to Israel. And a few months later, I live in Israel for the past year. I'm not on food stamps anymore or public assistance, really. I'm not broke. I did go deaf. And I do have a modest income now, but I'm making it. And I live better here than I did in Morristown on very little. It was a wake-up call that we're not our things. We don't even need our things. We truly only need God. And it was a miraculous experience. And then living in Israel compared to the United States of America, where we're very rich in America, and I think Americans really don't realize how the rest of the world lives. And just to give you an idea, I'll spend a couple of minutes explaining how different things are in Israel than in America. I moved here, and I literally came with the clothes on my back and very little else. And I have a beautiful three-bedroom apartment that costs probably a third of what I was paying for a one-bedroom apartment in Morristown. Things are much less expensive here as far as housing. But this life here in Israel is much more simple. People don't take things for granted like we do in America. The living space is much smaller, and everybody utilizes every square inch of their living space. I used to have a living room in America in my home that we barely ever sat in, and it had a fortune worth of furniture that we never sat in. I had one mirror. This is how over the top I was when we had money. I had one mirror that was probably, I probably spent thousands of dollars on one wall hanging mirror. That's unthinkable here now. And it's unthinkable to me now when I have no money left in the world. But what you think you need, you don't really need any of it, because you come into this world with nothing and you leave with nothing. And the wake-up call came to me, and it was hard. It was hard to let go of everything, but it's also freeing. It's completely freeing. When I say food stamps to freedom, I am spiritually free. I still have debts to pay from when I went into debt over running on love and trying to launch my dream, but I'm making it on very little. I don't own a car. I don't have extra, but I have the smile on my face and peace of mind. And I left it all so that I could walk with God and be free to worship God and speak of Him how I want, when I want, and be free to be me. And doesn't everybody deserve that right to be free, to be themselves? So with that, I'm going to open the talk with my dear friends, Deb in Delaware and Anna Marie in Chicago. Hi, Deb. Hi, Anna Marie.
Hi, Lori.
Hi. So, happy birthday, Anna Marie.
Thank you, Lori. And yours is coming up soon.
Yes. I am going to be 57 years old. Unbelievable. And you know what that means? My Hebrew birthday, the Hebrew calendar is different than American birthday. And my birthday, my Hebrew birthday and my American birthday are the same this year and only happens every 19 years. So I'm old. This is the third time. Yeah, it's great. So we go back way back 30 years. That's incredible.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
So Deb, did you have a question?
No, I just wanted, before we got started, I just wanted to let everyone know that, as Lori said in the beginning, we're talking live on Facebook, and if anyone is looking to ask her specific questions, they can either type that in to the comments or they can call us directly on Blog Talk at 516-387-1346. So I just want to put that out there before we get started.
Yes. This is an important topic. You guys know me a long time, both of you. Deb, I know you almost 30 years. Maybe even 30 years now. I don't even know what year we met, but a long time.
Getting close to that, yeah. I just kind of want to talk about what you were, highlighting today about, the path to where you are right now, and especially where Running on Love is right now. And as you've been putting out these countdown
days,
keep Running on Love going, and just want to remind everybody that you're putting these posts out every day, and how important it is, and how critical it is right now to try to get some support to keep things going.
Thank you for bringing that up. I did set a target date and a final date of December 25th for the cutoff for Running on Love, because Running on Love's been running on me for my life savings and my efforts for 7 years. It just had a 7-year anniversary, and it's truly been a labor of love. And Deb, you've been involved with pretty much every event I've ever done over all those years, and they were beautiful and uplifting, but I can't do it on my own. It was never meant for just me. It was meant for everyone else.
I know.
You were there way back in Asbury Park. We did an event. We had 8 people running and walking for love that day in a the relay marathon in Asbury Park. It was beautiful. Everybody raised money for different charities of their own choosing and honored people that they loved with an act of charity. And I don't know, we were getting together and we were doing training runs and walks and people were getting fit. There are so many benefits to running on love. It's more than just raising money for charity. It's a spiritual awakening for people when they run on love. It's really changed lives. And I hope you're one of them, Deb. I think you are.
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, all of the events that we did together, you know, one of my favorite parts is just watching the people that were involved in the event and how emotional they were when they talked about, you know, why they were doing it and honoring their loved one and just the pure joy of, you know, doing it in honor of them. And it was just a pure joy to be part of it. And I loved every event we did together. And I know it was, you know, your life's passion to try to grow this. And you always said that, you know, if you couldn't get the support, you know, to expand it or to keep it going, it's something that, you know, you'll always do, you know, in a small way for yourself. And I guess that's where we are right now is, you know, you have taken this further than...
Further. Well...
You know, and... Yeah. You know, but it's really up to everyone else now. And you've given it your all. And I'm proud to be your friend and to be part of it all these years.
Thank you. You know, I am at peace with this. It's sad to me. I actually... You know, Jewish people, when someone dies, they sit Shiva for a week in mourning. And I literally spoke with Hashem this morning, or yesterday. And I said, I don't know if this is halachically acceptable, Jewish law, to sit Shiva for something that's not a person, but running on love is like a member of my family. God forbid, poo-poo. But I feel like I'm going to need a week of mourning to let go of this, if that's the outcome. But I'm at peace with this because I did give it my all. And I have to also say that running on love gave me more, believe it or not, than I believe I gave it. I gave it everything. I worked at this so hard and I gave all my money. I'm still in debt. I'm literally $30,000 in debt over this. It's crazy, I know. But I couldn't let go of it, and I always felt I was on the precipice of the world getting it and running with it and getting addicted to it. But it never happened that way. And now I'm putting it out there and asking people to donate $5 or $10 and spread the word that this is something very beautiful. And it's day 28, and so far there's no donations, but we'll see. You know, we have some time, and it's like I feel like I'm doing a countdown to Christmas Day and telling people how many more days they have for shopping. You know, that's what it feels like. Like no one's getting it, but I have to let go of the outcome. And this morning I was emotional about it because I'm putting it out there. And Israel's literally having arson and fires. And this morning I woke up and there were four ISIS terrorists that were shot dead like 20 minutes from where I live. So I know that we need love. We need this. We need to come together and we need to become educated that we come from love. That's what we come from. Hashem, God, is pure love. And so we need this. So I was upset this morning. And Deb, before we went on the air, I told you I had a conversation with Hashem. And I said, I'm so upset. And he said, Lori, you have to let this go because it's not yours anymore. It belongs to them. And either the world, the people of the world support this and begin to pay for this charity so that it grows wings and people begin to run on love, or they don't. It's their choice. It's not your choice anymore. And then he even painted an even bigger picture for me than the one he did on that Sabbath, where he said, if you lost everything, would you be okay if you just had a bed and my voice to wake up to? Well, this morning he said to me, Lori, if the world blew up tomorrow and there was no more earth, wow. And he says, and you left your body and died and you came to me, would you be okay? Yeah. He's everything. He literally, he's breathing the air is extra. He's everything. And he said to me something very profound that I hope you understand, and really it starts to resonate with anybody listening to this. We really are spiritual beings having a physical experience, and we come into this world, and then we're people. We have bodies, and we grow up, and we grow old, but we deny that we're going to die perhaps one day, and we pretend that it's not real, and we manifest in this world like we've got forever. And so he said to me this morning, he said, Lori, if this is your last day on earth and you're going to die tomorrow, you're going to come to me. But today, what are you going to do today if this is your last day? And I thought about it and I said, well, I'm not going to cry over this. I gave it everything. It's sad if it dies, if running on love doesn't live on. I'm sad, really, Deb and Anna Marie and anybody who's listening to this. I'm sad for you because I run on love. That's literally what I do. This is my belief system. Perhaps it never should have been a charity. Perhaps it never should have ever been a business because it was never a business to me. And people tried so hard to get me to make it about the money. And I said, no. If this becomes about the transaction fee, if this becomes about things, then I'm out of here. It has to be about the pure message that we give because we love, and it's really modeled after God himself. He just gives. You know, he gives because he's God, and that's what he does. He just gives, and that's what running on love's about. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's about who we love. Maybe that's why it's not working out in this world, because everybody wants something, right? We need things, and charities need things too. So the charities that I tried to encourage to run on love said, well, we need more money. We can't give you a percentage of the donation. It's all about our charity. We can't share. And people are not gravitating to the message of just give and let go and don't worry about the outcome. And that's really what it's about. Give until it feels great and celebrate.
Lori, do you have a vision for post-running on love, let's say that it doesn't get the donations you need?
Yes. Well, I think that's why I'm okay with it. I'm writing my book, and I'm sharing. And I know that running on love was part of my purpose, but it's not my whole purpose. I'm writing the book of what happened to me over these 7.5 years, very powerful lessons. I lost my hearing, and Hashem opened my eyes to see the world and all the problems and issues that we're having right now. I see them very clearly, and I need to share what I see so that we can, God willing, people will read my book, Anne Marie, and start to learn. And start to, we'll come together. That's what I'm hoping in the future, is that I will write this book, people will read it, and I will go out and speak to people and share the lessons and the wisdom that I have acquired over these years.
Okay. Now, I have another question.
Yes.
During those years when your life was falling apart and you were losing your hearing, every time we talked on the phone, you sounded just calm and accepting. Is that the strength of your relationship with God? Is that why it came across that way? Or were you just not wanting to let me know?
Well, it's interesting. My father always said, don't let them see you bleed. So there's a little bit of that, Anna Marie. I cry, and you know, you hear me choke back tears all the time. I do. I'm very emotional. Yeah. But I save my tears for Hashem. And someone said that to me once. They said, you don't have a bottom. And I guess I don't have a bottom because he catches me at the bottom. Literally. There were nights where I was crying, sobbing, and I'm a sloppy crier. When the tissues are flying, you know, I'm not like Angelina Jolie or someone like that. I'm a very sloppy cry. And so at night, I always keep tissues by my bed and I cry and I throw the tissues. My life is terrible. And even in the middle of that, he can make me laugh. He makes me laugh at times when I don't want to laugh. I literally could be in a foxhole, like I said before, with bombs flying. And he holds me so tight, and he's in my face, and he'll say things that make me giggle when things are terrible, literally terrible. So I think it is him. It really, I don't think it is him. Everything is him. And I, you know, the thing that I want to do is share him so much, because if I could just give a droplet of him to you or anyone, you would never be sad. If you knew how awesome he was. People talk about him. God is great. God is awesome. God is awe. He's even better than that because he has a personality. Did you ever figure that God had a personality?
No.
Yeah. I always said he must have a great sense of humor. With all that he has to watch, the way we try to navigate our lives, you know,
yes,
when we make our plans, he probably has a good laugh at that.
Yeah. I think, did I tell you the story, guys? I'll share it now because I never shared it on Facebook. But I was so upset one night and I was crying. My life is terrible. I need a hug. Can't you just come to me? You know you can do anything. Come through the closet. I said, I don't even care if you're 4 feet tall and 600 pounds and you look like an ogre. I don't care. I just need a physical hug. And just at that moment, he said, Lori, do you want to know what I look like? I said, what? He said, you want to know what I look like? I said, okay. And in that very moment, he flashed Homer Simpson in my head with big black bushy eyebrows. And I'm telling you, I was sobbing, crying. I started laughing so hard I thought I was gonna split my side open. He's hilarious. He's wonderful. He has an amazing sense of humor.
So then the laughter became your hug?
Yes, actually, yes. I'll tell you what it's like now, though. It's very strange. They say God is within all of us. And that's true. We're all a piece of God. But he is so magical that he can actually take over my limbs and I can feel his hand within mine and he can go like, you know, touch my hair. And it feels like someone else's hand is comforting me. I know it sounds bizarre and freaky. It's a little like, do you know the movie All of Me with Steve Martin and Lily Tomlin? You know the movie I'm talking about? It's hilarious.
Yep.
Lily Tomlin was this rich, eccentric woman who wanted to have a chance at life. And they had this Indian guru that took her soul out of her body at the moment of death. And somehow it fell out of the bowl and landed inside, her soul landed inside Steve Martin. So they shared Steve Martin's body. And it's hilarious. But my life is a little bit like that. It's with God. It's kind of freaky, but funny. He's very funny. And there are times I'm shopping in the supermarket and he will crack a joke. Nobody else hears it, but I hear it. And it's sort of very inopportune because I'm walking down the aisles of the ShopRite and I'm trying to conceal that I can hear him and he's making me laugh. And I'm like, please stop it. You know, it's like being a child in church or synagogue or class, and you're not allowed to laugh. So he's very funny. He's very beautiful. So anything else you want to know?
Well, Lori, I was just going to say, and the flip side of that, you know, is I know, especially this during this past week, there's been all these fires and this terrorism. And, you know, how has he been able to comfort you through that?
The terrorism?
And the fires.
Oh, the fires. I can't hear that well, but you said the fires and how I'm coping with that, or?
Yeah, I was just saying how, you know, how has Hashem been able to help comfort you?
Comfort me.
Through all this stress in the past few days of what's been going on all around you?
Well, he does comfort me but he does tell me the truth and he shows me things that are terrible, that the world is really in a state of terror, danger, and we turn it off and we can't live with knowing that we're in peril every minute. It's you can't live like that. So you have to turn it off. And he does comfort me, but he also warns me that there's going to be more and more. And we know this. You know this. Both of you. Everybody knows that we're heading for more. And the only way to mitigate that and stay strong is to know that it's all on purpose, that people choose this. The evil people choose to hurt the people, the good people of the earth. And God, Hashem, has to allow this to come through. And it's hard to understand when he is so awesome and good and loving, why he would allow things like 9/11 to happen or these fires to occur. And the simple short answer is we're free. And you know, that's a perfect segue to the name of this program, Food Stamps to Freedom, is we are free. We're free children of God. And that means that comes with a price. The people who choose the opposite of God is something that we have to reconcile with and we have to deal with. So he has to allow a certain amount of this to come through. And it's really a wake-up call. These fires, the four terrorists that were killed right across the way from where I live, it's a wake-up call to all of us that we're in danger and that we're participating in a lot of this, and it's not okay anymore to participate in the behaviors that are breeding terrorism. It's a deep conversation, but every time you choose something that's not God or good, you're participating in it. And I hate to bring this subject matter up, but the election, you know, Donald Trump, Clinton, the Democrats, the liberals versus the right-wing Republicans, all of that rancor and anger and nasty conversations and self-righteousness and calling each other names, all of that is terrorism. I know, is that it? Am I over-exaggerating it to you? Because it is.
I guess to be honest, it seems extreme to call it terrorism, but I understand your point.
What I mean is it's the seed, Deb. It's, you know, the minute you think that you have all the answers and the other people are idiots, that's the seed of terror. I have the answers, you're stupid, and you chose the wrong president, or whatever. You know, I don't want to go there because I'm going to make everybody angry, because it's a very hot issue. We know this. But the minute you start calling other people names and calling them idiots because they don't agree with you, it's the seed of evil, of terror. If you act out of anger and you speak out of anger and you don't reserve it, we all get angry, but we should never act or make decisions out of our negative emotions. Does that make sense? And that's what people are doing.
Sure.
They're doing things that they shouldn't be doing. And it's a seed. And it's, well, look what's happening with, I think someone got pulled out of their car because he had a Trump sticker on the back of his vehicle and he was beaten up or something. Do you recall that? I mean, it's terror. It grows.
Yeah.
The evil grows.
Far, yeah.
Yeah. So we're seeing it grow everywhere. And it's really easy if you're in New Jersey to point to Israel and say, wow, that's terrible. It's burning in Israel. I'm glad I'm in New Jersey. And I was there before I moved here. I was running in Morristown and there were stabbings all over Israel. People were being killed literally with knives. They were being knifed. And the night before I was supposed to move here, I was in the fetal position and I'm screaming, Hashem, what am I doing? Why am I going to Israel? Oh my God, what? And he laughs at me. He said, Lori, Israel, believe it or not, is safer. You're not going to want to hear this, guys, because you're in America. But he said, you'll be very safe there. It's, you know, it's everywhere. It's an illusion that you're safe here in New Jersey. And I said, really? He says, really? Because they're awake in Israel. They're ready for it. You're not ready for it in America. Look what happened in Orlando in that nightclub. You know, if that, God forbid, that happens in Israel, it's done. They call it neutralizing the terrorists. They're gone. But in America, it's mayhem because you're not ready for this. And the next morning, well, that was the night before. The next morning, I woke up to go for a final run in Morristown. And I'm running down this pathway that I always run down by the water. And I look up. And I see a man without a shirt, with tattoos all over him. He was half naked. And he had a big machete. A big machete. And he was whittling this piece of wood with the machete. And I look around, and I was alone. And I said, oh my God. You know, this is crazy. You know, he didn't do anything, but I was scared. And there, you know, in America, there's no soldiers walking around with machine guns ready to kill someone if they mess around. But in Israel, it's unnerving. If you guys came to Israel, you would see 18, 19-year-old boys with loaded machine guns. It's a lot different here. But you learn to be comfortable with it, actually feel safer with that going on. It's a surreal universe. You know, sometimes I wake up, guys, and I say to myself, where am I? You know, like the F Troop. Did you guys watch F Troop when you were little? The Hekawi Indians. How they got their name? Where the Hekawi? You don't remember that? I feel like a Hekawi Indian here. Hashem, where am I? It's crazy here. Anyway, so we'll see what happens to Running on Love. But December 25th, Christmas Day, which is also the first day of Hanukkah, is my deadline. It either takes wings and people support Running on Love, and it flies around the world, and, well, meaning it doesn't have to have events to continue for another year. It just needs to sustain itself, because like every charity, there's accounting fees, there's website hosting, everything costs something. So it needs fuel, and I don't have the fuel. And Hashem knows that if he gave me a little extra money, guess where I would spend it? And he says, right. It's not up to me anymore. He said, you're not doing it anymore. He made it literally impossible for me to spend money on this anymore. I don't have it anymore. You know, I just bought... What was that?
I'm sorry, where's the best place to go online to donate to Running on Love?
Well, the website, runningonlove.org/donate, goes right there. Or the website, okay. The homepage, there's a donate button, runningonlove.org. And I also have my own campaign set up. It's another website that I'm running, my last Run on Love, perhaps. But I'll continue to Run on Love. But it's my last fundraiser, perhaps, we'll see. In January, it's givelovetouchlives.org/Lori, and I have a page set up in memory of my father. But either way, the easiest is runningonlove.org and click donate. And I hope people will. I'm going to warn you guys. I told Anna Marie, Deb, you don't know about this yet, but I have a song parody that Hashem made up for me. And he wants me to sing it to the world. It's a song parody about Running on Love. And Anna Marie said I should hire someone to sing for me because I don't have a singing voice.
So maybe that's a good idea.
I can hold a tune, believe it or not, even though I'm deaf, I could still hold a tune. But he wants me to do this. So that might, I'm going to pull out all the stops for this. I think about Donald Trump did. And like two to 3 weeks before the election, we know the video that went public about what he said, the horrible thing he said. I won't repeat it. And he's president. Oh my God, right? So I shouldn't quit. It's 28 days, so I'm not going to quit. I'm not giving it up. But I'm kind of leaving it, what's the word? What did you say that year that you moved to Delaware, Deb? Let it go, let it flow. So I'm kind of letting it go, letting it flow. And if I'm putting it out there, and I'm praying every day that people will run on love and donate a little bit and maybe tag three or four friends and donate a little bit. And, you know, 3,000 people later, we have a charity that has some money to do some good. But I don't know. I'm going to pull out all the stops. I'm going to have fun with this. Maybe I'll sing to you. And you'll donate just to make me stop. Shut her up. Give her some money. Shut her up. So, well, keep praying, guys. You guys have been, wow, support Like, I can't even imagine. I love you. I love you guys. And nothing would make me happier to have Running on Love in Delaware and Chicago and everywhere. I have a vision of these events, multiple events. I think big. Multiple Running on Love events connected with live feed like this. It's, you know, Deb, you're the multimedia expert. We would be connected with big screens and we would have these global events where people could run on love in different locations but be connected through Skype or Facebook.
It could happen.
It could happen. And it wouldn't really require a ton of money. It would require some money and manpower, but it would require people really wanting this to happen. And there is a plan. There's a business plan. You know, you've been to two events. People really had spiritual experiences at these events. They really connected. It was very emotional, very beautiful. So I'll keep praying and keep putting out my daily updates. I thought about saying tomorrow, see us again tomorrow, same bat time, same bat station. I'm very, very, very old. So.
And Lori, we're with you.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I feel like Batman and Robin. Hashem is Batman and I'm Robin, and we're going to save the world by running on love. And you guys, you know, Hashem has said that Tveria, that Santa Claus is coming to Tveria this year. I don't know what he's bringing me, an empty sack, a sack full of coals. But maybe you guys, if it's good news, maybe you guys will be my elves and hand out, I don't know, running on love hats on Christmas Day somewhere.
Sounds good.
Sounds good.
Nice.
Well, thank you guys. And I hope this was a meaningful broadcast to everyone who's listening, anyone who's listening. Please share and please go to runningonlove.org/donate and donate a cup of coffee. Starbucks, what is it? $5 for a latte. Skip it. Run on love. And share, share, share. Peace on earth, in our world, for every person, now. Let's not wait. Okay?
Amen to that.
God bless everybody. Amen.